My name is Serhii Plokhi. I'm the director of the Ukrainian Research Institute, and we continue with our Monday series of our seminars. Today, my pleasure is to introduce to you Iiuri Zazuliak, who is a research fellow at the Institute of Ukrainian Studies of the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine and associate professor of medieval history at Ukrainian Catholic University in Lviv. And for Iiuri, we all welcome him back to his old HURI and Harvard family. He was here a Sklar Fellow in the year 2008. So it's really a great opportunity to have you back and see how much you progressed or we progressed, what happened in the field as a whole of medieval and early modern studies. Given especially latest development in Ukraine, we have been paying a lot of attention to contemporary developments. So this is in a way a flashback to the good old times of the beginning of the Institute when medieval and early modern studies really were front and center of the research that we were doing here. So Dr. Zazuliak's main academic interests are in the area of war, dispute settlement, violence, and social relations in late medieval and early modern Poland-Lithuania, with special emphasis on the region known to most of us as Galicia and for some of us as Red Ruthenia. His most recent publications include Jus Ruthenicale in Late Medieval Galicia, Critical Reconsiderations, published in Imaginations and Configurations of Polish Society from the Middle Ages through the 20th Century, published in 2017. So today, Dr. Zazuliak will be speaking on a really fascinating topic of, a little bit scary topic, of slavery, violence, and the origin of serfdom in late medieval Galicia. So without further ado, I turn the floor to Dr. Zazuliak.
Thank you very much. First, I would like to say that this is a great honor for me to be invited to the Ukrainian Studies Seminar at HURI, and I would like to thank the Institute and personally Professor Serhii Plokhi for this great opportunity to present my rather modest research finding on late medieval slavery and violence in late medieval Galicia. And I would like to start with one legal case which was recorded. I don't know whether it is seen, but which was recorded in 1448 in the register of the land court of Halic. And in that year, a peasant called Zeyn of the Net brought to the land court several complaints against his former lord, Jan Kolia from Martino, who was a member of one of the most powerful nobleman families in the Halic land. Complaints were recorded and preserved in the register of that court, and one of the claims is especially revealing and valuable with respect to the topic I would like to address today. Zeyn accused Jan Kolia of the violent captivity and enslavement of his daughter Catherine. Zeyn stressed that Kolia's action has been violent and illegal wrongdoing, which has not been supported by the verdict of the court. He also added that Catherine had not been the slave before. In his response, Jan Kolia proposed an alternative and by far more detailed account of the event which led to the enslavement of Catherine. He stated that he didn't take Catherine by force, but her captivity was a consequence of the crime which Zeyn himself had committed. Jan Kolia related that Zeyn was guilty of instigating thieves against him. The thieves, with the assistance of Zeyn, had robbed his house. When Jan Kolia learned that thieves had been instigated by Zeyn, he set up a special judicial trial. Apparently, it was his patrimonial court against Zeyn and sentenced him to the high monetary penalty of 60 marks. At this court proceeding, Zeyn confessed to his crime, but having been unable to pay such a huge sum of money, begged his lord for the mercy, and offered as a compensation his daughter into slavery. And afterwards, the legal record surveyed the most shocking and interesting detail of the account. If we believe, the words of Jan Kola, then himself cut off the nose of his daughter when he gave her into slavery. And apparently, and jurors, however, were not able to adjudicate the case and transferred it to the consideration of the special judicial assembly of the land. Apparently, the new slave was not sufficient compensation for Kola. Then he additionally accused Kola of pillaging and violent seizure of his goods and livestock, which according to the plaintiff comprised a considerable amount of money. Those complaints were written just down just next to the record about the enslavement of Catherine. The court, however, declined then claims and released Kola from all those accusations. It seems that by the time the claims were brought to the court, then he had already managed to move to another village and change the subjection. In the records of his dispute with Jan Kola, then he's referred as a peasant from another village, from Belshov, which is a village close to the Halych. And this village belonged at that time to the Halych captain Nikolai Parava, who apparently became his new lord. And then migration to Belshov could be taken as a possible clue pointing to the source of his conflicts and legal disputes with his former lord. The suggestion could be that his enmity and legal dispute against Kola arose from his attempts to receive from his lord the confirmation of his right to the Lviv, the so-called pravo vykhodu, which would allow him to pass to another lord. No verdicts regarding then daughter survived, and therefore nothing is known about her fate. The records leave a historian without definite answer about the veracity of stories told by then and Jan Kola. Their accounts, as related and recorded in the register, were constructed according to the modes of representation and documenting facts in contemporary legal practice. They were thus the realities of the legal process. Although we have no chance to determine the balance of veracity and fiction in those stories, the given evidence could be estimated from the perspective of the possible horizon of behavior in conflictual relationship between lords and subject peasants in late medieval Galicia. So one can say, on the basis of the claims brought by Zayn, that some peasants were able to reach the relatively high level of prosperity and influence in that time. The well-off and influential peasants like Zayn did not hesitate to start enmities against their lords by taking recourse to violence or calling assistance of professional robbers, to sue the lords to courts to respond for the wrongs, and in case of the unfavorable outcome of the conflict, they attempted to find another place and another lord for the residence, using for the legitimate right to the exit or transit. And one can say that the record depicts there as a typical situation regarding the spread of the peasant violence, criminality, and particularly theft in the land of Galicia during this period. The case is rather exceptional in another regard. As it is mentioned in the record, Zayn was not only accused of directing thieves against his lord house, but he was also presented as a perpetrator of the crime, that is, mutilation of his own daughter, which helped him to redeem his own life. In this way, the record shed some light on the connection between violence and patriarchal power in peasant households, which also had some parallels with power of the noble lords over their subject peasants. At the same time, the record illuminates another interesting and important aspect of the social history of Galicia during the late Middle Ages, namely the continuous existence of slavery. The slavery in Galicia is attested already by the sources of the 12th and 13th century, and various forms of slavery continue to exist in the region during the next centuries as well. The evidence to the history of slavery in the 15th century Galicia survived exclusively as records of the local castle, land, and municipal courts. Those courts were established in Galicia as a part of the Polish administrative and legal order, which was finally introduced in the region in 1434. Just here is some basic chronology. And as it is known, since the loss of its dynasty in 1340, after the death of its last ruler, Blessed Iiuri II, the lands of Galicia and Volhynia were conquered and integrated in, by the rulers of Poland, Hungary, and Grand Duchy of Lithuania. And after the Polish conquest in the year of 1434, Galicia was transformed into the Rus Palatinate. To the region, but this part of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, and here is Galic and Lviv as a capital of the new Rus Palatinate. And Palatinate in itself was divided in four lands, with the centers in Senjuk, Peremysh, Pshemysl, Lviv, and Galic. And one of the most important effects of these administrative and legal changes was the introduction and establishment of new type of courts, that is, castle, land, and land courts. And for the 15th century, we have the registers of those courts. They survived in a considerable number. When the slavery concerned, there is only a small number of evidence which survived in those courts. They are several legal records of dispute regarding the sale of slaves, the few mention of the domestic slave servants, mostly females, and the reference to the enslavement in connection with the administration of criminal justice, similar to this to the case to this legal case of Zen versus Jan Koller. Overall, they leave no doubts to the fact that local noblemen, townsmen, both Christian and Jews, were slave owners and took part in the slave trade. Some sources reveal, for example, that slaves were bought in lands of Grand Duchy of Lithuania and then transported to Galicia. Others mention the presence of slave women among the domestic service of noblemen. Apparently, the situation of those slave maid servants, they are called in local legal records as ancile libere, was similar to Catherine, though the sources do not describe in detail the circumstances which led to the enslavement. It is known from one record that one of these women had been sold in slavery as a kid. There is no information if some of them were assigned or mutilated, as in case of just mentioned it above. Though we know that some female slaves which were brought to Italy from Eastern Europe during the late Middle Ages, they were assigned or marked. This is at least what I read in some studies of slave maid servants in Italian late medieval towns. And existence of private slavery in Galic Rus must be viewed in a broader context of the widespread of slavery in Eastern Europe and Eurasia in that time. Galicia was on the route of the slave transportation from Italian colonies in Crimea and North Black Sea region to Europe, and Lviv in that time, Lviv-Lemberg, as the capital of the province, was a station for this international slave trade. The municipal registers of Lviv Council, for example, contained several records which listed the names and description of female slaves who were transported from Kaffa, that is the major Genoese town in Crimea. And transregional dimension of Galic slavery was also shaped due to the neighboring location and contacts of the region with the Turkish world. The Ukrainian borderlands of Polish Crown and Grand Duchy of Lithuania were major areas of the slave supply to the slave markets of Crimea, Ottoman Empire, and Near East. And I cannot provide numbers for the 15th century, but for the later period of the 16th and 17th centuries, some scholars like Dariusz Kołodziejczyk has estimated the number of slaves from lands of Poland, Lithuania, and Moscow, slaves which were caught in regular Tatar and Turkish raids and wars on 10,000 per year, which comprises 2 million in two centuries between 16th and 17th century. And this amount is approximately equal to the transatlantic slave trade of early modern period. So the slave trade and slave ownership in late medieval Galicia were thus part of the larger transregional market of violence, let's call it, which existed in early in Eastern Europe and Eurasia during the Middle Ages and early modern times, and which represented a lasting and important structural trait of region history. However, the evidence illuminating the history of local Halych slavery are much less numerous, less diverse, and less informative in comparison to sources available from the territories of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania or Moscow. For example, source materials from Galicia provide no evidence which are of crucial importance for the investigation of slavery in lands of northeastern Rus, such as reports of self-sale into slavery, contracts of debt slavery, so-called Kabbalah, or aristocratic testaments which listed the number of slaves available in the households of masters and which were liberated or manumitted at the death of the master. Also, no text of statute, a codified law, preserved from the territories of Halych Rus or Polish Crown, which could match the Moscovite or Lithuanian legislation of the 16th century and legal codified law from these lands are known for their very detailed regulation of the slavery, especially regarding the types of slaves and the legal and social basis and sources of enslavement. And in my talk, I would like to deal mostly with one type of slavery attested by the above-mentioned record of the dispute between Zeny and Jan Kola, that is enslavement, which was consequence of the judicial verdict against a person accused of the crimes and which could be accompanied by the tortures or mutilation of the culprit. The aim is twofold. First, to highlight the existence of slavery as a form of punishment in the contemporary administration of criminal justice, and second, to demonstrate how the slavery could become a part of the specific regime of lordship of a dependent peasants by comparing it with the uses of violence by noble lords against their subject peasants who wanted to leave their estates. And by this, I will try to draw attention to one rather neglected aspect of the emergence of serfdom, that is the second serfdom of the late 15th and 16th century, by emphasizing how violence by noblemen operated as instrument of limiting peasant freedom of movement. Presentation is also designed as a historiographic critique. In my opinion, the evidence of penal or judicial slavery similar to the one described in the case between Zeny and Jan Kola allowed to reconsider the widespread historiographic view on the slavery in late medieval Galicia as an institution of exclusively Ruthenian law, which originated in time of the early medieval Rurikid polities. I would like to demonstrate that it is not always possible to find and prove that such forms of enslavement were connected directly with the Ruthenian law. Instead, such cases of enslavement must be investigated in the broader context of the 15th century dynamics of noble lordship and peasant subjection, administration of criminal justice, and commoners' criminality. In other words, they must be situated in the social and institutional context of the 15th century Halych society. In historiography, the Halych slavery was usually interpreted, as I mentioned, it as one of the manifestations of the local Ruthenian law, whose institutional and normative background extended from the slavery of the Kievan Rus times. This view has been mostly fully elaborated in the work of the Polish historian Wojciech Heinosz, which was published in 1933. Heinosz qualified majority of cases of slavery in Galicia as a servitude of the Ruthenian law. He also made one important reservation, however. According to Heinosz, there was difference between forms of slavery existing in early medieval Rurikid polities and various survival relationships of late medieval Galicia. The servitude in Galicia during the 15th century was a specific institution of the local, according to Heinosz, local Ruthenian law, which was not merely a continuation of social and legal institution of the period of Kievan Rus, but reflected also the transformation of those institutes in new context of the late Middle Ages. Heinosz described the servitude in late medieval Galicia as a special kind of, he used the term przypisaństwo, adscription, it could be translated into English. According to Heinosz, it restricted the personal freedom in many ways, but still was not identical with slavery. Heinosz insisted that the status of such bondsmen in Galicia was similar to that of various groups of local royal servicemen. Now about those royal servicemen. The common trait of such servicemen, which decided about their unfree status, was subjection to the power of local royal officials. That the servitude manifested itself in various, sometimes very specific obligations, which they carried out to the castle, royal castles, as well as in the royal jurisdiction of such servicemen. Heinosz also pointed out that most of those servicemen belonged to the Ruthenian law. And I must note that there are no sufficient evidence to support this argument about the Ruthenian law of the servicemen. According to Heinosz, they were survivals of the old ducal organization of castle and service population, which preserved from the Rus or Halych-Volhynian times. Simultaneously, the dependence of the servicemen on the king and his officials gave their servile status more public character. For example, their unfree status did not preclude that some of those groups from being privileged royal men. They had the legal capacity to possess and acquire land property, to respond in royal courts. Some of them were granted special royal privileges, which made their status even attractive to the private dependent peasants. In this regard, Heinosz made a clear difference between the forms of slavery which he believed existed in early medieval Rus and semi-servile status of the Halych royal servicemen of the 15th century. And according to Heinosz, there was no considerable difference in legal condition between the royal servicemen on the one hand and private serfs on the other hand. Private serfs were not slaves, according to him. They were only unfree because their service to the lord was permanent and hereditary, and they were devoid of the right to leave their masters. Otherwise, similar to the royal servicemen, private serfs preserved some important public rights and legal capacity. To support this point of view, Heinosz brought, for example, the evidence showing that in one case a private serf was present at the proceeding of public court and his name was written down among the jurors attending the court session. To continue with the example, one can also mention local Jews who often performed services to the royal captains and kept important public offices like royal customers. Given the considerable financial risk and financial obligation that those Jewish servants took before their patrons, they often balanced it on the edge of losing their personal and their family's freedom. uh, But in my opinion, the Hainish concept of the specific model of servile relationship existing in late medieval Galicia, which was distinct from the slavery, but encompassed both the royal and free servicemen and private serfs, is open to criticism because it intended to neglect the variety of forms and experiences of local servile relationships, which could also include slavery. It seems that Hainish sometimes underestimated the significant differences in status of various private serfs and slaves, as well as overlooked some details in the source evidence which point to the specific circumstances and context in which their servile status was established. For example, the sale of men, attested by several legal records, was not for the Hainish a sufficient proof of the slave status. Hainish also was very cautious in interpreting the Latin terms like sklavus or its Polish equivalent niewolnik, even if both words were used to describe the status of men owned or bought by local noblemen. This great precaution in interpreting the legal terminology of sources led Hainish to stress impossibility to describe precisely the social relations behind such legal terms. This approach can be seen sometimes well-founded in view of the great deal of ambiguity which can be found in some evidence. I believe, however, that scholar's skepticism can only partly be justified by a precautious attitude he adopted towards the sources. Hainish analysis of sources suffers often from the evident one-sidedness. His interpretation was clearly pushed only in one direction and was aimed at proving at all costs that there was no true slavery, but only a specific type of the servile dependency, the adscription, przepisaństwo in Galicia. As a result, Hainish often ignored details available in the sources which allow another, sometimes even more straightforward interpretation. It is exactly the analysis of the record of the conflict between Zeny and Jan Kola, which shows that the concept of the servile relationship as a kind of adscription in Galicia, as it was proposed by Hainish, cannot be extended on all cases of slavery. This piece of evidence was well known to Hainish, and his interpretation was marked by the explicit skepticism regarding its possible explanation in terms of slavery. On the one hand, Hainish doubted, following perhaps the opinion of another prominent student of Galician, late medieval Galician history, Ivan Lenichenko, whether one can really infer from it the existence of the custom of mutilating slaves in Kiev and Old Rus. Lenichenko pointed out that this is perhaps the only case of slave mutilation from the lands former lands of Kiev and Rus known to him, so there are no other cases of this practice of mutilating slaves in the sources of Kievan Rus times. And this statement could be further corroborated by observation made by Richard Healy, who also stressed the lack of practice of signing or marking slaves in medieval and early modern Russia. Hainish also was inclined to view the story about enslavement of this Catherine, this peasant woman, as still another proof of the time-limited servitude, as a widespread practice of giving a person in the temporary servitude to compensate monetary debts. For him, such debt servitude was not identical with slavery. And here, Hainish clearly draw parallels with one of the category of time-limited servitude existing in Kievan Rus, that is zakupe, zakupnetsto. As it is known, the temporary sale or self-sale in slavery caused by the hunger, debts or incapability to pay pecuniary fine is illuminated sufficiently in the narrative and legal sources of Kievan Rus, which suggests the spread of those type of slavery or servitude. The expanded version of Ruska Pravda deals with all this type of serfs or slaves, the kupe, and also temporary holope. Still, in my opinion, the Hainish attempt to interpret the Catherine enslavement as a case of time-limited servitude established for the monetary debt seems unconvincing. It is simply not in the text. The record speaks of the slavery without setting any temporary limits for its duration and present it as a judicial punishment for the crime of theft, which probably aimed to substitute the death sentence. The version of the story of Catherine enslavement as told in the courtroom by her father supports this interpretation. It is to mention that Zane insisted on violent and illegal capture of his daughter by his adversary. It was in his view, it was an action which had not been validated by official verdict of the court. On some other plausible grounds, the interpretation by Hainosh of the case of Catherine enslavement as a temporary debt slavery seems not completely satisfactory and pleads for further consideration. First, the sum of the pecuniary fine in 60 marks or grivna, which was presumably imposed as a punishment by Jan Kola on Zane, was one of the highest in the contemporary Polish law. The royal status of the corona, namely the status of King Casimir the Great from the mid 14th century, which it was a major legal text for the statute law in late medieval Kingdom of Poland, determined that such high fines for committing some exceptional crimes like the murder of the high-ranked nobleman by the peasant. For comparison, the pecuniary fines imposed on the peasant found guilty of killing a knight or nobleman of two other lower standings comprised respectively only 30 and 50 grivnas. A peasant convicted of killing another peasant paid only 3 or 4 marks. So some amount of 60 marks was really extraordinary in administration of criminal justice. And in administration of criminal justice of the Rus Palatinate in the 15th century, only extraordinary grave crimes like the threat to set fire, heresy, or destruction of mills were subject to the punishment by such high pecuniary fines. And one can assume that pecuniary fine of such amount was a symbolic equivalent of the capital punishment in the contemporary law. The culprits, especially commoners and poor peasants, if they were incapable of paying such fines, found themselves totally on the mercy of the plaintiffs or royal officers who had convicted them in the court. Such convicts could be executed or turned into slaves. Under such conditions, the slavery was just a delayed death sentence. At the last, one has to confront the fact that even the sale or self-sale into slavery did not necessarily mean the temporary enslavement. And here again, I could refer to the Richard Healy, who showed in his study of the Moscovite slavery time-limited slavery often evolved into full permanent slavery. The evidence of the legal record suggests, Galician legal record suggests that much less expensive price of sale in slavery than that indicated in the legal case between Zen and Kola would lead to the long-term, perhaps lifetime enslavement. One of the records provides, for example, a testimony of the slave maidservant made in the public court. She testified that she had been sold in slavery still as a kid for just one copa of grosche, which is not comparable with the 60 marks. And judging by this evidence, the testimony was made when she was already adult. And this could suggest that her slavery lasted for quite a long time and was only loosely related to the price of her purchase. In general, if seen in the comparative context of the history of female slavery in the contemporary Europe and Eurasia, the evidence of the durable lifespan slave condition of women attested in the sources of Galicia seems to confirm one valuable observation by Susan Mosher Stewart. It was exactly the female slaves, mostly maid servants, whose status underwent no significant changes from the times of antiquity, and the opportunity of their manumissions in late medieval Europe were minimal if compared with the male slaves. The case of the enslavement of Catherine is not unique with respect to the application of such form of punishment in the contemporary administration of justice. Another telling evidence of the servants and their families who were turned into slaves because of their criminal offenses is provided by the following agreement between big lord, the captain of Przemysl or Peremysl, Jakub from Konitspole, and his servant and personal barber called Johannes Wand. An agreement was recorded in the register of the local castle court, which was presided by Jakub from Konitspole, because as a royal starosta, he was the head of this court. And by this agreement, Wank gave himself and his family in the hands of Jakub of Konitspole and expressed his will to accept a voluntary perpetual slavery. The record specifies that the enslavement was a consequence of the heavy crime committed by Wank, though there is no idea from this record what was the crime, for which he would have been otherwise liable for the capital punishment. And the surrender was further conditioned on the promise made by Wang to the captain not to try to liberate himself and his family in any possible way from the servitude. If promise broken, the captain or his successors were empowered to find, detain, and punish Wang with a penalty which was prescribed for thieves and which presumably meant capital punishment. The record also omitted to mention terms and conditions under which Wang and his relatives could be released from the servitude, which suggests its full and hereditary character. In the comment on this record, Heinosch remarked with some caution that surrender of Wang to Jakub from Konitspole could be interpreted as evidence of the libertas iuris ruthenici, the servitude of the Ruthenian law, and needs to be explained as a peculiarity of social and institutional context of late medieval Galicia, which was for him different from the rest of the kingdom, Polish kingdom. There is, however, no or very little ground to assume the connection between the surrender of Johannes Wang and the norm of the so-called Ruthenian law. The record never refers to the Ruthenian law. A close link between the office of royal captains and the Ruthenian law is usually dated on the period before 1434, that is, the time before the introduction of the Polish legal and administrative order in Howard Rus. But this record is dated, was written down in 1417, that is 40 years after the establishment of this new order. Another remarkable feature of the record is that it is not Ruthenians, but people of other ethnic groups, a Pole of the highest social standing, and his servicemen of presumably German origin, who are major protagonists of this story. So there is no really nothing suggests that one can link this case of enslavement to the Ruthenian law. At the same time, the crucial aspect of the evidence which allowed to lead its interpretation in another direction than suggested by Heinosch is the act of submission to the will of the master and the begging for mercy. The acts of submission undertaken by culprits like those described in the cases between Jan Koller and Zen, or between the captain of Przemysl and his barber, played a key role in rituals and procedures of the contemporary legal justice. Submissions usually were accompanied by public rituals of begging for pardon and mercy performed by the convicts, their relatives, or even bailsmen before the captain or the private master. Yes, and So my preliminary conclusion could be that this kind of judicial slavery played some probably important role in supplying new slaves who by their original social standing belonged to the native, dependent, and poor peasants. From this point of view, the social relationships and the criminal justice in Halych Rus of the 15th century look like a continuation of the early medieval practice. And we can find some other evidence of this type of enslavement, which were a consequence of the heavy crimes committed by commoners or peasants. But if we try to widen the context of such types of enslavement, one can say that, for example, this acts of public submission of the of the criminals and their enslavements, as they are described in legal records of late medieval Galicia, one can see some parallels with this practice, and for example, with the institution of proschenike or pushchenike, which existed in times of Kievan Rus, these two terms probably describe a category of culprits who committed heavy crimes, but who were granted life and enslaved for the rest of life instead of having been punished by death. And similar forms of enslavement were also recognized by the law of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The first Lithuanian statute from 1529 enacted that capital punishment of the criminal offenders, except for the thieves, could be replaced by their enslavement, and recognized and statute recognized it as one of the legitimate sources of slavery in the contemporary society of Grand Duchy of Lithuania. At the same time, some trends in the criminal justice and criminal legislation of Central and Eastern Europe during the 15th and especially 16th century sought to introduce more severe corporal punishment and more death penalties for some types of criminal offenses, including theft. So, for example, in the legislation of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, precisely the thieves were defined as a category of criminals which could not be exempted from the death punishment. The law forbade actually the enslavement as a substitution for the death penalty. And this ban on enslavement was further secured by threats of sanctions against those who dared to show mercy for such criminals and enslave them, but not punish them by death. Basically, my criticism of the heinous concept, the essence of my criticism is that the attempt to drawing a clear conceptual distinction between slavery and this particular form of servitude invented by Heinosch and call it ascription seems only to complicate, but not to help to understand better the servile relationships in late medieval Galicia. Heinosch advocated a definition of slavery which emphasized the most extreme practices of subjection of humans by humans. According to this definition, slaves were deprived of all human rights, and slavery meant the absolute social death of the subjected men and women. In contrast to this ideal type of slavery, Heinosch sought to introduce the concept of przypisaństwo, which he extended on all forms of servitude existing not only in Halych Rus, but also in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. As a consequence, Heinosch rejected altogether the existence of slavery, possibility of the existence of slavery in late medieval Galicia. This interpretation is, however, difficult to sustain, at least for two reasons. First, the type of slavery Heinosch argued for was never dominant in majority of slave-owning societies. The widespread model of slavery existing in late medieval and early modern Eastern Europe permitted the slave to act as a legal persona. They were able to secure, with consent of their masters, some basic legal rights. And the most serious objection to the Heinisch conclusions or his interpretation, however, concerns the term przepisaństwo. It is purely academic term, which was proposed by some Polish medievalists as a translation of the category of dependent peasants known from the Latin-speaking documents of medieval Poland as adscripcji or adscriptici. The term was used in the charters of immunity and donations issued by the Polish rulers during the 12th and 13th century, which granted church institutions and secular aristocracy with some lands, but together with lands came also peasants, which were enumerated or listed in those charters. And they were actually bound to the land or to these estates. But this term was never used in the local legal sources of Halych Rus. And by proposing this term, Heinos sought to clarify the relations of the slavery to some other forms of servitude. However, the local sources often present a relationship of subjection and slavery without sufficient conceptualization. Therefore, it seems doubtful if the ambiguities and difficulties of the source evidence regarding this legal and conceptual boundaries between slavery and other forms of peasant personal dependency could be resolved by introducing this new concept, which actually lacks any support in the local sources. In my opinion, the slavery without doubt was known in the contemporary Halych society and embraced the wide range of experiences and manifestations. So we have evidence of mutilation of slaves, people were sold and bought, and this is probably could be considered as a proof of the existence of hereditary slavery and permanent slavery relationships. But on the other hand, slavery and subjection, servitude and freedom, were very unstable categories with loosely defined conceptual and semantic boundaries, which, what is important, were never fixed and fixed in stable and clear terms of official law and jurisprudence of the Polish kingdom. But instead, they were constantly renegotiated and open to the frequent changes in various situations of daily confrontation and interaction between lords and subjects. The only statute law, or the only text of the statute law which mentions the existence of slavery in late medieval Kingdom of Poland is one paragraph of the so-called Krakow Warta Statutes from 1420 1423. And one of the paragraphs of the statutes, while regulating peasant flights from their lords, remarked that the slaves and slave maidservants had no other ways to be released from the servile dependency except for the manumission. The paragraph mentions the numerous cases of flights of such slaves, who by breaking the ties of subjections try to pass with their goods under the protection of other lords. The law compared the flights of slaves to the loss of other hereditary property by lords. The noblemen to whom the runaways turned for the shelter or started to live in their estate were obliged to denounce such runaways in the nearest session of the land court or royal court. If they didn't, they were punished with a high pecuniary fine. Although the terms of dependency used in the paragraph describe primarily the slaves and servile servants, it cannot be excluded that this provision was also an attempt to extend this kind of terminology on other categories of peasants. And it is important, for example, that this legislative text, which regulated and prosecuted runaway slaves, was supported by it referred to the norms of the Roman law, which is rather unusual for the statute law of late medieval Kingdom of Poland. In Krakow-Warta statutes, the Roman law is called imperial law. And according to imperial law, we know that colons, that is these dependent tenants, who had run away but had been caught by their masters, or even if they only had meditated the flight, but their intention had been exposed, were to be chained and turned into slaves. On the other hand, the invocation of the Roman law in this paragraph was probably not accidental, but could be deliberate due to the quite similar forms of punishment of runaway peasant practiced in Poland during the 13th and 14th century. So the runaways were usually turned into slaves in early modern, early medieval Polish society. And on the other hand, the usage of terminology and appeal to the Roman law can be regarded as an episode in the process of creating new ideological and conceptual foundation of the peasant serfdom during the 15th and 16th centuries. The comparison of peasant to the slaves probably worked to reinforce the ideological effect of the legislative norms strengthening the serfdom. It is not accidental, for example, that during the next 16th century, the term colonus came to substitute the category of kmet, that is, these rich peasants in the Polish land war. And this term colonus became actually equivalent of the peasant bound to the land, that is equivalent to the category of chlop or in general poddany. I don't know how many time I still have.
Next maybe few minutes, if you are ready to.
Okay, just coming to conclusions. I have to omit all this problem related with uses of violence in context of the peasant right to the Lviv, which also reveals some parallels when we speak about punishment. With parallels with these cases which I presented here, and it is also important that for that dispute between this peasant and his former lord, it probably originated because of the conflicts surrounding the peasant appeal and peasant wish to pass to another lord. In my opinion, the analysis of evidence of enslavement, which are found in legal records from the 15th century, suggests that it is difficult to qualify them as specific manifestation of the Ruthenian law, or to trace their normative and legal background from the wars of Kievan or Old Rus only. The representation of all those different by their origin and context cases of slavery as mere remnants of the Kievan Rus institutions or as a form of the local survival relationship of the Ruthenian war leaves without attention one crucial problem of the slavery in Galicia, namely the existence during the 15th century specific practices of noble lordship which enabled the enslavement of dependent peasants and made boundaries between slavery and other forms of servitude ephemeral. And enslavement of the daughter of this peasant Zain or the barber of the Przemysl captain demonstrate how big words combined private and institutional resources and used judicial and extrajudicial forms of violence to establish harsh forms of servitude, which sometimes could be similar to the slavery. Hainish was inclined to underestimate, if not reject at all, the role of royal officials, local magnates, and noblemen in practicing the slave ownership by pointing out to the negative attitude to the slavery in the Polish law, in the Polish land law. However, the example of Jan Kola and Jakub from Konitspolje prove the opposite. The royal captains and members of aristocratic families were engaged in enslavement of their own subjects and peasants. It seems that it was exactly the captain criminal justice in Galicia which operated for a long time as a crucial institution which maintained this type of servile relationships by condemning the criminals to the slavery. The fact of the disapproval or rejection of slavery in the Polish law doesn't contradict this in my interpretation. The agreements such as one concluded between Jakub from Koniecpole and Johannes Wang, or the acts of submission and pleading of convicts for mercy before the captain attest to the considerable degree of captain's self-will in administering criminal justice, which were not bound directly by principles of any codified or ethnic law. It is possible to speculate that captains, while administering criminal justice, did not really make too much difference between their role as a royal official and their conduct as private lords. In other words, it was their status and power as big lords, not the norms of statutory law, knowledge of which was highly limited and incomplete in late medieval Galicia, which provided efficiency and legitimacy to their activity as royal officials and judges. A capacity to act violently by using both legal and extra-legal means and resources was a distinctive feature of the nobleman institutional power of command and justice, which laid ground for the expansion of serfdom and servitude. Thank you very much.
A little bit more light. Here we are. Thank you very much for this presentation. I have a number of very specific questions, but I'll start with a broad one. And the question is about really the study and historiography of slavery in Ukraine and in Eastern Europe in general. Your research and your presentation is, in my opinion, is very few attempts to deal with that topic, and I have an impression that there is some stigma attached to the very idea of slavery, especially when it comes to the development of historiography and national historiographies. One thing that it seems to me you're pushing against is the idea that, okay, that the slavery, it's really about Ruthenian and Ruthenian law. You're trying to say that the picture is more complex. And I remember publications of articles by Halenko about the slavery in 16th and 17th century Ukraine, which was also basically very, it was a touchy subject. So it looks like slavery and national historiography don't go nicely together. And it's very different, it seems to me, from the way how the issue of serfdom is treated. Yeah. Serfdom is there, Shevchenko is born to serfdom. It becomes transformed, it seems to me, into something that is productive for the national myth and national mythology. So there is no stigma talking about serfdom in the Ukrainian context or in Russian context. But when you think about the Soviet historiography of Kiev and Rus, it seems to me Greco, maybe I'm thinking, maybe making things up, but there are attempts to basically downplay the serfdom and the importance of serfdom in Kiev and Rus. So I wonder if you could talk about that, whether this is really something that is happening and there is stigma attached, and then what is happening now broadly in that field that would also help us to put your particular research in that broader in that broader context. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Should I answer?
Yeah, and then we'll go.
Well, this is very complex question. I would say that we can witness probably the renewal of interest in slavery in recent historiography. Besides the excellent studies by Richard Healy, which I already mentioned, there are also a number of other works which actually try to provide very broad comparative perspective on slavery in a very one can say, global geographical context of the Eurasia. When it goes about, when the Soviet historiography concerns, then obviously this interpretation of Greco was a dominant, but on the other hand, in 70s, for example, a number of excellent studies were written by Zimin or Froyano, which somehow tried to propose this alternative interpretation and emphasize the importance presence of slavery and slaves in not only in early modern societies, Rus world, but also in later medieval during the later Middle Ages as well. I have no answer to this very, very intriguing and very interesting question about a kind of social intellectual stigma which surrounds a study of slavery. Probably this is in present-day Ukrainian historiography. Probably one can explain it as reaction to the kind of Marxist methodology and these visits, emphasis on social issues, history of social classes, social struggles. I don't know. I have no good answer to this question.
Thanks a lot. I think that was a very good answer. I was also thinking that Halley is, of course, someone who is not exactly the favorite historian in Russia, or Zimin was had major problems with the official Russian historiography, Soviet historiography at the time. So, but again, thank you for your answer. So, Michelle, please, and then Pete, and then.
This is a related question. I'm thinking comparatively with with historiography in of Western European feudalistic period, and I'm just sort of wondering. Here, there's in your talk, you're addressing and taking pains to try to separate out slavery from being bound in land, serfdom, or some kind of peasantry, and you're trying to think of it in explicit and implicit legal categories, and trying to tease out some kind of formal categories that distinguish slavery from bound peasantry, serfdom, something like this. I'm just wondering if this preoccupation might be kind of unique in this period to Ukraine right now, because I'm not sure that are historians of Western European feudalism also trying to make this distinction between slaves and peasants, serfs?
Yes.
Is this is it?
Yes.
So this is okay. All right. Well, you answered my question.
All right. Yeah. So, if you have anything to add, so of course. Please.
Well, actually, this is very long historiographical debates and discussions, and we can find such debates in Russian historiography, in Polish historiography, where the serfdom, this new serfdom of early modern serfdom, was really rooted, partly rooted in. In survive relationships, or somehow influenced by slavery, or for example, this is very well known argument by Vasily Kluchevsky, who was first to suggest that all these forms of judicial Moscovite slavery from late medieval and 16th century times, that they somehow were very important for the origin and for the establishment of the Russian serfdom. in the later time. And also in the Polish historiography, there were a debate between Franciszek Bujak and Kazimierz Tyminecki, which focused exactly on this topic. How, to what extent the serfdom was based on early forms of slavery. I'm not a very good expert on Western Middle Ages, but I think that at least my impression from works, from studies of Pierre Bonazzi, who actually emphasized this very long history of slavery, which existed until the Carolingian times or even later, and which somehow was interwoven with this new regime of serfdom, in already medieval serfdom.
Can I just comment on this specific point, if it's possible? I know one of the problems in the Western medieval sources is that the same word is used for slave and serf, which is servus.
Yeah.
So when do you determine that someone stops being a slave and starts becoming a serf?
And when you bring women into it, we have very famously publicized serfdom of recent vintage, like a couple weeks ago in Hollywood. You know, it's in effect, what is a slave? You know, if we're going to ask what in effect is someone who is bound to acknowledge someone as absolute master, I think it becomes a very, very difficult issue. It becomes almost, well, maybe too difficult to tease out who is a slave and who is a peasant.
Yes, and even this paragraph of one of the texts of statute law, Polish statute law from the early 15th century, where we have these terms like slave, right? But there is a lot of debate. What does it really mean?
Like niewolnik.
Servus also, but because this is in Latin, it is not clear whether it refers to the slaves or to the peasants in general, dependent peasants. So,
this is very interesting. I find that the question that Michelle was putting is actually very central. Is this a technical difference that really is? Proposes no fundamental difference, say slavery and serfdom, according to the people who experienced it, from what we can tell from the 19th century, it felt like slaves.
It was a power relationship.
This is how Shevchenko describes it. You know, it's a technical difference that doesn't have any existential meaning. That's one thing. The other thing, I think that there's an awful big component here of national historiographic denial. You know, of accepting serfdom because it was imposed by a supposedly occupying power. It was foreign, and therefore, you know, whereas slavery, if perpetrated by or with native actors being complicit in it, selling their children to the Tartars or the Turks or whoever were the slave traders. This is the Helenko argument, which I fully buy. I think that this is instinctively true. But of course, that's no historiographic argument. This is something that has to be argued and proven. Is a phenomenal collective trauma. And therefore, as the Polish historian you were mentioning is continually, Heinos. He is Polish, is he not?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is continually finding arguments for saying this isn't ours, this is Ruthenian law, which we inherited. You know, and the Ukrainians saying generally we never did it. You know, this is a fundamental issue here, I think. And somehow historiography tends to, as you were suggesting, somehow work around it. There's a stigma, but it's sort of fundamental. And especially since it's not a, as you were suggesting, it's not only a 13th or 15th century phenomenon, but a 20th century phenomenon. I mean, literally, 21st century phenomenon.
If I may, one remark to this very good observation, because exactly in the 15th century, in Kingdom of Poland, the literary tradition of the very harsh criticism of the peasant serfdom originated, and authors who wrote in this tradition, they explicitly compared the peasant serfdom to the slavery. So from the 15th century, we, for example, have a famous speech of one of the professors of the Krakow University, Jan from Ludziska, which he addressed to the King Kazimierz Jagiellończyk, in which he compared peasant servitude to the slavery, and but also appealed to the king to release peasants from servitude. And in 16th century, we have already Polish humanist influenced by Renaissance ideas like Andrzej Fritsch Modrzewski, who argued in the same way and compared also a peasant condition to the slavery. And this literary tradition it probably somehow reached its peak in Enlightenment, just before the partition, right? And
but also in the 17th century, explaining the Khmelnytsky wars,
yes.
You know, that this was inevitable, that this had to happen, and this is a curse waiting to fall on Poland. Yes.
I mean, the sort of formal definitions, which aren't terribly helpful, is that a slave is owned by a master and can be moved around. Of course, in practice, most slaves stayed put, and a serf is bound to the land. But in practice, most slaves didn't move and therefore were, in essence, de facto bound to the places where they were. And, you know, this debate will never be resolved. Michael Confino and Peter Colchin argue back and forth. Confino's saying, well, no, serfdom and slavery are quite different. Colchin arguing, no, that they're really one and the same. Just in the case of late Muscovite history, by the 17th century, you do find legal documents in which slavery, in this vein, holopstva and serfs, and there's no real name for a serf, but serfdom exists, are pretty much one and the same, used interchangeably. And in the early 1700s, Peter the Great, who needed money, abolished slavery because slaves don't pay taxes, but serfs do. When I was, just one aside, then I'll get to my question. When I was in Poland working for a year in Iha, Pan, in Wiczański, and Suheni Grabowska, and some of the others there, I mean, this discussion would come up, and particularly in the instance of who are the obskrypcji, and I never really got a clear understanding. It was just sort of nebulous. My question to you is, leaving aside this business of the second encirclement, which I do not buy, it ultimately goes back to Engel's 1892 letter, which, of course, is picked up in the early 30s in the great Soviet debates on what is feudalism et al. When do you feel serfdom comes or starts to appear in Galicia?
It's again a question, what do we mean by serfdom? Is it labor service?
On Russian, a brok and barshin are two types.
Yes. So we can find already in the 15th century that peasants were forced to perform the labor service yes.
Okay, well, panchtina then, I guess. That's the Polish term.
Yes.
In Ukrainian, it's...
it's the same.
Okay.
But this labor service, right? In English or not. Oh, I think, yes. You can find the 15th century
it's
documents.
It's not corvée labor?
Corvée or
well,
service.
Labor.
Yeah.
Not quit rent, which is a brok. And I don't know the Ukrainian word for that. We didn't really have a brok in... in Ukraine.
But it will be rent or something like that, yes. Or change, which is then tax which each peasant paid in cash. But
so
also
does this exist before the reign of Kazima Jagiellończyk?
You mean the
labor service?
I think you can find some documents where labor service is already mentioned. That is 40s and 50s of the 15th century. So it's exactly the mid 15th century when you can find mention of the corvée in local documents and legal records. But at the same time, it is not clear whether it was weekly labor service, which became a dominant form of peasant labor in the 16th century, or it was still a certain number of days which peasants were obliged to work during the whole year. So that's a basic difference, and also the issue of the debate. Again, another issue is what came first, the labor service or so to say a peasant bondage to land. So what influenced what? So is this kind of labor or legal bondage of peasantry?
Well, I think as land space starts to get filled up, landlords realize that they've been exploiters all along, but could now really get away with it.
Yes, but this is also a little bit of paradox, because already in the 15th century we have all major institution of the nobleman lordship our peasant established: patrimonial courts, labor service, all kind of payments and taxes, restriction put on the right to the leave or to the exit. But still, my impression is that during the 15th century, peasants' freedom is still exist. But this situation somehow changed dramatically during the next 16th century. So in this sense, one can still speak about this second serfdom, probably.
Okay, thank you.
Well, my comments and question were also in this general area, and as the discussion has developed, the area of my comments has been shrinking considerably, but I still would like to say that it seems to me, especially on the basis of the discussion, that there is some confusion that in my mind is not yet resolved, that involves both the nature of servitude, and that is complicated by the terminology of the nature of it. And the terminology also has a twofold kind of division, because there's the contemporary terminology, the servus and everything else, and the terminology that we try to develop today, as analytical tools. And it seems to me that there is, quite a bit of clarification that is still needed. I'm reminded of the debate that is arising in this country in places in connection with, the rethinking of the Civil War experience and the period of slavery, that a point that has been made, I'm not following this very, very closely, but a point that has been made was that there was a type of bondage that affected the white population in the 17th and 18th century that was quite akin to slavery in many ways. But it's not called that, and that is
servitude.
And so, in our case, in the United States, I think that discussions of this sort are complicated by issues of race. In the case of Ukraine, perhaps it's by the national element that George, has pointed out, and that also has to be, I guess, taken into account when we discuss. My question actually is about, you know, whether there is a way to clarify the role of Ruthenian law in this that you mentioned, whether that was really the source. You know, there were parts of the Polish crown that had never been under Ruthenian law. Could not some comparison between the experience of those be somewhat illuminating, as also on, you know, the experience of Galicia and those Ruthenian or Ukrainian territories that were under the Grand Duchy? So, you know, I'm just wondering whether this kind of comparison, both with West and East, might help.
Well, regarding the different meaning of this term Ruthenian law, I try to focus only on the lens of how it's Rus, right? And it was one of the type of this village law on which peasants were settled. And it was a somehow conceptual way to differentiate these peasants of Ruthenian law from other types of peasant dependencies which could be governed or regulated by some other types of law which became widespread in Galicia during the late Middle Ages, like German law or Wallachian law. So it was different types of village social and legal organizations in Galicia of that time which coexisted, but also somehow influenced each other. So whether we can speak about some very specific form of slavery of Ruthenian law, there are actually evidence which suggests some relationship between slavery and Ruthenian law and influence, that it could be named a specific institution of the Ruthenian law, and some group of these royal servicemen who were unfree men but still privileged, right? They were governed by the norms of Ruthenian law, so they were subject to the Ruthenian law. This could be seen as a form of servitude based on Ruthenian law. I don't know whether I answered your question.
Well, it goes a considerable way. Yes, thank you.
I'm sorry. Is it possible to pull up the legal case that we were looking at before? I was just interested in.
We need a password.
Oh, never mind. I was just interested in notions of culpability.
Mm-hmm.
In the case you discuss with Zen and Jan Kola and the daughter Katerina, who is punished for her father's sins, basically. I mean,
yes.
It's a very weird case. And so I was curious, it seems, if I understand the case correctly, that her father has the choice either to pay 60 marks of silver,
mm-hmm.
or to enslave his daughter, even though the daughter is not the one who has actually committed the alleged crime of inciting thievery. And so my impression from that one case was that it seems like the head of the household, who is a man, is responsible for the behavior of his entire household, and that is the legal justification for her enslavement. But I wondered whether there are other cases with this legal principle, like, for example, if an animal breaks into another person's field and damages crops, which I know happens in, for example, medieval Irish law, is it the animal that's put to death or the peasant that owns the animal who is punished? Or, for example, can a wife give legal testimony in court against her husband, or they're treated as one legal person? So I was interested in the dynamics of culpability within the peasant household in the one example that you gave, and how that works, because it seems like such a strange situation that she would be punished even though she had nothing to do, presumably, with inciting these thieves.
Yeah, but this is a very good question and probably not easy to answer, but I think that this case shows that a peasant could be also considered as a kind of lord, members of his family or family group, right? So he's a master of life and death for other members also. So some other cases also suggest this practice. For example, I mentioned the case when and this testimony made by the a female maidservant who testified that she was sold into slavery, but it is probably someone who sold her, right? So it is most probably some other members of her family who did it, and but this case also interesting from because it shows that how lords or noblemen try to integrate or make peasants responsible also. So peasants are not only victims of this regime of lordship, but they somehow also are responsible for maintaining the existence of these dependencies, right? So they could be integrated into the system of lords justice and there were different networks of responsibility and liability established by lords, but also by lords and peasants, so who somehow tried help lords to maintain their power, right? So about animals, I think that some statues from the late Middle Ages, they made owner of the animal liable for the crime committed or some wrongs committed by such animals.
Thank you.
I have a more specific question than the one that I started with, and that deals with the evolution of the Ruthenian law. So if one accepts the idea that Rus starts as a slave trade incorporation, and there are people who claim that, the fact that slavery is an important institution in the Rus law is probably not a major surprise. But what happens evolutionary from the Rus justice to the first Lithuanian statute, to the second Lithuanian statute, to the third Lithuanian statute, as the Grand Duchy of Lithuania legislation is being adjusted with the one of the Kingdom of Poland? Do we have any evolution there?
Well, this is again great historiographical debate how all this Rus law and legal institution influenced Lithuanian statutes and Lithuanian legislation. And it is also infused with this not only scholarly but also ideological implicit meanings, because in 19th century many Russian historians, they maintained that all Lithuanian legislation is mostly based on the norms of Ruska Pravda, and many of these norms were borrowed from Old Rus law, but again, this is not always easy to prove that such and such norm was directly borrowed and from these times. I think that this is more, so to say, practical relationship of lordship, regardless a codified norm, because during the early Middle Ages and during the Middle Ages in Eastern Europe, codified law was not, so to say, there are not many people who were expert on this law, and the knowledge of its norms was not so well established or applied in the practice in the administration of practice at the local level. Yes, my impression is that this is this, so to say, daily and routine practices of lordship and relationship between lords and dependent peasants, which were more important and which shaped these legal norms, which were constantly changing and very actually flexible legal customs, which was not always attached to or strictly related to the some legal codified norms, at least during the Middle Ages.
Thank you very much. Wonder if there are any questions or comments. Well, if there are no further questions or comments, let me thank our presenter for a really thought-provoking topic, and thank also for doing research in the field that I still believe is very underdeveloped, certainly in our historiography. So thank you very much.